petty and unfair. They're unjust and unlovable. But when we see you, Adonai, our hearts rejoice and we are drawn to you. We love you because you are kind, because you are good, because you are merciful. We love you because you're slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. We love you because you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we love you because you first loved us. Thank you for being who you are, a God worthy of our deepest loyalty and our highest affection. And yet we confess, God, that we have not always loved you as we ought to and as you deserve. Too often we have loved ourselves far more. We've chosen to do what pleases us rather than what pleases you. We have chosen to pursue our heart's desires instead of yours. We have spent far too much time being drawn to the gods of this world. We were born in a state of rebellion against you, and we have deepened that rebellion throughout our lives, but we see it now with the pain of regret. And we confess our sin and our sinfulness, the sins we committed, and our very tendency towards sin. Forgive us, Lord, for each and every time we put ourselves above you, when we broke your law without consideration. We thank you, Lord, that you do forgive. We thank you that you have forgiven. We thank you that your heart is ever inclined toward forgiveness. Your love is deep and strong and true. Thank you that your love does not waver or wither. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who restored a relationship that we ruined, that you have bound up what we have broken. Thank you that you have enabled us to come to you and thank you, and that you tell us to come as we are, and then incredibly, after all we've done for you, to you, you receive us with open arms. Thank you, not just for making us, but for making us new again. And Father, now, since you've invited us to bring our prayers before you, to speak so you can listen and respond, and because you've told us to do these things, we bring you our petitions. We do lift up Ukraine and our brothers and sisters there, Mark Priem and his church, and Yakov and the Christians in Kherson. We pray that you'll continue to give them the boldness they need to do your work. We also pray that you bring them peace in a troubled time and continue to protect them. Confound the enemy, Lord. Send them away seven ways. As they go about doing your work, let no one hinder them or stop them. Place before them doors that no man can shut. Lord, we thank you that Glory has returned to her fellowship this evening. I pray that you continue to be with her. Help her get her breath back and breathe deeply again. We pray for young Saccone, that you'll continue to heal, continue the work you've already begun in her, and continue to heal her. We lift up people who are suffering, Lord, from unspeakable tragedies in our own country. Still, the parents in Texas are grieving. And now we add hospital in Tulsa. Lord, it is heartbreaking to see evil on the march, unchecked by the Christian church. Help us all, Lord, to lift up prayers to you. Help us to lift up our prayers as holy ammunition in a spiritual war to push back this darkness that is pushing against us. We ask also, first and foremost, that you would receive the glory through anything we do this evening. In the midst of all of our praise to you, that you will hear it as a sweet sound in your ear. We ask that you would help us to be faithful, for we cannot do this without a spirit in our lives. We want to be faithful to you. We want to do what you tell us to do, to value what you tell us to value. We ask that we would live out our love for you by loving one another, that we would live with kindness and patience and generosity toward each other, that we would exemplify the virtues that we so perfectly see in you. We ask that we would comfort one another in sorrow, that we'd forgive each other when sinned against, that we'd be slow to speak ill of one another, and quick to point out every evidence of your grace in their lives. We pray that we would live well in this world as faithful neighbors, faithful employees, faithful students, faithful friends, faithful families. Help us to have a good reputation in those around us, that others may come to know you through the example of our lives. Help us to live in a way that displays the gospel and makes it look attractive. Help us to be quick to tell others about Jesus. Help us to carry out your work in this world and to serve as your representatives. We ask, Lord, that you would keep us faithful, that you would preserve us to the day we see you face to face. We ask only to see that day when we would stand together before the throne as brothers and sisters, but now perfectly holy, rejoicing in all you are and all you've done. That is our great reward. Lord, please continue to show us your love. Continue to help us to love you the way we have been so perfectly and wonderfully loved by you. Watch over us, Lord. Holy Spirit, take over the service. Let your words be spoken as you bring us heart to heart with the living God, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so our scripture reading today is from Psalm 36. Your love, Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the highest mountains, your justice like the great deep. You, Lord, preserve both people and animals. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights, for with you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Okay. And you hit everything about the movie that you wanted to talk about the praise in the mountains is coming up on the 11th. There's a flyer in the back for anybody who wants to know that. We are now on week number 7 of our Renegade series. But you will remember me. Remember me for centuries. Is it just one mistake? Is all it will take? We'll go down in history. Remember me for centuries. Remember me. This is actually kind of a two-part sermon because we're building up right now to the most famous battle in history. That's next week. This is the build-up to that. If I had the energy, I'd do a two-hour sermon, and we just go straight from this one to the next one, but I don't. So you guys get to go home, relax. I get to gargle with salt water, and we'll come back, and we'll finish this next week in what is still, to this day, my favorite sermon. So I hope you guys make that one. But this is important because we're setting up now for the battle. And if you don't get the setup, you won't get the battle. So we have to spend some time on this. But before I get there, I have to do a disclaimer. And the reason is because we love to look at the Bible stories and make ourselves the heroes. It's something we all do. One thing I love about David is there's so many opportunities to do that. He did so many great things, right? And so being the hero of David's story is much better, actually, than being the hero of mine. He did better than me. He did bigger things than me. But in our effort to do that, and I'm not saying that there aren't, obviously, I'm going to be talking today about certain allusions, allegories from the Bible and how it applies to your life. But we have to be careful a little bit. Don't walk out here saying, yeah, I'm just like David. Probably not. Maybe you are, but everyone's supposed to be like David. But I want to point out a couple things about the giant we're going to be talking about for 2 weeks. And this is important. And in fact, it's so important. I was thinking about this today. I'm going to actually insert another sermon into the series after next week. What is that?
Too dark.
Yeah. Well, my lighting person left. I don't know what to do about that. A little more light here. Some people say they want to see me. I don't know why. All right. I look better in the dark, but okay. Anyway, so where was I? I was talking about Goliath. Okay, so yes, there are things in your life about that's similar, but there are some of the same things that aren't, and I want to show you. I'm going to add another sermon in the middle of this, which isn't about David, but I felt like there are different kinds of giants you're going to meet in your life. The one we're talking about for David is a very specific one. If you try to do what David did, and it's not your giant, it's not going to work out well for you. So let me just point out a couple things about David's giant. Goliath was not opposing David. This is something we kind of forget. He has to insert himself into it. The giant is opposing the army of God, not David. David's not even part of the army of God. So when David gets there and sees this, he jumps into a fight that's not his own. Oftentimes the Goliaths that we're facing in our life is our own, right? And so it's a little bit different. So he saw this thing differently. Second of all, David, and we'll talk about this a lot more in the upcoming weeks, never gives Goliath authority. A lot of the times the giants in our lives are there because we have given them authority to be there. You can't fight them the same way David fought them if you have given them authority to be there. And finally, David fought Goliath just for the good of the kingdom of God. He didn't intend to get anything out of it. So many times we think if we can knock down this giant, we're going to go on to some great thing in our life, right? We see a giant as an obstacle. And that's not what Goliath was. He was not an obstacle to David at all. But he was a stronghold for the enemy. So let's just be careful a little bit with biblical allusions. Some of these things are going to fit, some are not. We'll talk a little bit more about other ones. But so let me start off with what set up the little background here to what's going on here. We pick it up in 1 Samuel 17. This is a small skirmish. This is all it is. It's probably a territorial fight over a little tiny area, a little tiny village on the outskirts of Israel and the outskirts of Philistine, depending on where you are, right? And that's all it is. And so the Philistines roll into this village with their people, their army, a piece of it. And so Saul gathers up the army of Israel and goes to oppose them. They hear about it. They come, you know, in their army. And then all of a sudden the Philistines throw all their army there. And then Israel throws all their army there. And before you know it, this little tiny skirmish turns into a war, or at least a big battle. And they end up fighting across this ravine. Let me show you here. The Philistines gathered their forces for war and assembled at Socah in Judah. They pitched camp at Ephes Damim, between Socah and Azekah. Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up their battle line to meet the Philistines. So here's kind of a picture of it for those of you like me who've never been to the Holy Land. Some of you I know have. It kind of looks like this. And this, of course, is halfway down the hill, but if you kind of stood where Israel stood, you'd be seeing, you come down into this where there's this creek, you know, runs through it, and the other side is where the Philistines were. And so here's the problem. We're equally matched. They got their line of army there, and I've got my line of army here. Whoever attacks first loses, because they're just going to wait until you get down about to the river, and they're going to come halfway down the hill, and you're fighting an uphill battle. You may have heard that's not something you want. It's like an uphill battle all the way, right? Well, you don't want to fight an uphill battle, especially if you're undermanned or you're evenly matched to either one, because the nature of fighting an uphill battle would rule out the ability to easily win a victory. And by the way, your chariots are useless here. It's going to be hand-to-hand combat, soldier against soldier. And so what happens is they both realize that we have no numerical advantage, so whoever attacks first loses. So what do? Nothing. They stare at each other for 40 days. The Philistines occupied one hill, the Israelites another, with a valley between them for 40 days. I want you to picture this. Every day, you gather up in your lines, you go out there, and you shout at the enemy. You rattle your swords against your breastplate, your tent. You know, it's like the Baltimore fans and the Pittsburgh fans in the parking lot before the game. It's just nothing's going to happen there, but they're shouting insults at each other. They do this for 40 days. Now, that's kind of an interesting thing to do. But if you're called up as a conscript to the army, you're loving this. Because, hey, you're there. You know, I'm here. I'm a soldier. And I'm not fighting anything. That's really good. You know, I could be a soldier. I'm not even going to get a hangnail here. Now, the Bible flips back real briefly just to remind us the story they're really telling here. Now, David was the son of, remember him, David? It's like just last week we were talking about him. But they want to make sure, the author here. And he was the son of Jesse, and Jesse had 8 sons. Remember that? And Saul, in Saul's time, he was very old. That was Jesse. Jesse's 3 oldest sons, Eliab, Abinadab, it's easy for me to say, and Shammah. Why can't they all be named Shammah? That's easy. Had followed Saul to the war. So the oldest 3 sons of Jesse were already there. Not David, of course. He was a nobody, if you remember that. He's the 8th son. He's nothing. He's a shepherd who stays back home. So this is the thing. To kind of set the scene here, by the way, 3 of Jesse's sons were there. But for 40 days, these people just staring at each other, doing nothing. And if you're a, you know, baker or a candlestick maker, that's fine. But there were some professional soldiers in the armies. And they don't want to sit there and do nothing because their pay comes from conquering people and their fun comes from killing people. And so they want to have war. They want to start it. In other words, they want to pick a fight.
Where are you going?
I'm going to pick a fight.
Or as they say in Scotland, peck a fight. So I'm going to go peck a fight. And so that's what happens. A guy from the army said, this is enough of this. And the champion comes out and he tried to peck a fight. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out from the Philistine camp. His height was, I translated all this, by the way. They gave it to you in cubits and shekels. I have translated it for you. His height was 9 feet, 9 inches. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 125 pounds. He wore this like I wear a new member, no member's jacket. I mean, just like nothing, right? He just walks through. His spear was like a weaver's rod, which I have no idea what a weaver's rod looks like, but I would assume it's pretty thick. And his shield bearer went ahead of him, but the head of his spear, the head, was 15 pounds. This is like a lance, by the way, not the javelin. This is like he would fight with, but 15 pounds just in the end. That's something. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? Are you not the servants of Saul?" Now, I want to point out, he's like, hey, we're enemies. Why are you just staring? I'm a Philistine. You hate me, right? You guys are the armies of Saul. I hate you. Let's fight. Choose a man and have him come down to meet me. So he's saying, come down to meet me, which means he's up on the hillside. Maybe he's like halfway down the hillside. He's starting shouting to them from the other side. That's a pretty good shout, by the way, to be able to hear there. But he's a big guy. He's like, hey, come down here. Meet me at the creek, and I'll fight him. Meet me there. If you beat me, if you kill me, we'll become your subjects. But if I kill him, you'll become our subjects. Subjects will be slaves. And then the Philistine said, this day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other. Upon hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and all the army were dismayed and terrified. Now, I want to stop here and say one thing that kind of gets overlooked. This is not a real offer. Because they did sometimes in those days, you know, they would, especially in a case like this where you have battle lines drawn and nobody has any kind of an advantage, sometimes you would elect a champion to go fight for you. That's not what this is, just so we're clear. Because in order to elect a champion, the two kings have to have envoys, you have to negotiate it, you have to, you know, here's what will happen if you win, here's what happens if we win. Probably just give up territory. What Goliath is trying to do is trying to make himself more important. He's just a loudmouth. He's a strong loudmouth, but he's just a loudmouth. I just want to make that clear because of what's going to happen later. You think, why would they do that? Well, that's because this isn't real. The battle would be real. He would kill whoever stood in front of him, but this is not really going to be for all the marbles. So anyway, the interesting thing is the Bible says Saul and everybody was dismayed and terrified. Now, Saul would have been somewhere in the back of the army in his little tent, you know, so he wouldn't have necessarily been there, but he's gone forward every day for 40 days with this challenge. So word got back to Saul, you guys see this, and he'd go and see him, and Saul took a look at him, and he was terrified. Now, wait a minute. If you remember way back when we started the series, we met Saul, and Saul was picked for a specific reason. He stood a head taller than any other Israelite.
Am I a big guy?
Yeah, Johnny.
No. Look. See? You're the big guy. And we need you to start playing like a big guy.
Yeah, they've had a big guy. Only their big guy wasn't playing like a big guy. He was hiding in tent with everybody else. This does not bode well for the army. You can imagine how demoralized everybody gets because our king, okay, he's shorter than he is, sure, okay, because this guy's 9 feet tall, but Saul's 7 feet tall. That's pretty good, better than any of us who are like 5'8". You know, it's like, what about you? No, I'm not going to fight him either. I'm not about to do that. And so anyway, but I'll flash back to Jesse and his sons. And so Jesse says to David, hey, take this jar of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread for your brothers. Because they're probably not eating, right? And hurry to their camp. And I love this. Take all these 10 cheeses to the commander of their unit. A little bit of favoritism there, right? Make sure they get the good stuff. And just see how your brothers are doing and bring me back some assurance that they're okay. Because, of course, they don't know that they're sitting there staring at, you know, 40 days go by, they haven't heard anything. It's like, what's going on? Go find out, David. I'm going to go do that. So early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of another shepherd, loaded up, and set out for the Valley of Elah as Jesse had directed. I'm going to point out again, David is going to come on the battlefield, not as a warrior, but as an Uber driver. This is Uber Eats, right? This is all he is. He's not here to fight. He's got no weapon with him. They're sending him on an errand. He's an errand boy. He's a nobody, even his own family. Now, he's been training with the Holy Spirit for 3 years. But nobody knows that. I mean, they don't really know that. David's still the same punk kid as he was 3 years ago, as far as they're concerned. When he was baptized or anointed at age 13, well, he's now about 16. Not a whole lot of difference there in their minds. He's still just an errand boy. But he's obedient. I want you to see that he does what his father told him. Now think about this, because when we last saw David, he was anointed with oil, and he was told he's going to be the king of Israel. And then he sent back out the same sheep field he just came from, but with the Holy Spirit. Now, it would be probably easy for us, if we were David, to be in that sheep field going, oh, I don't know, I'm supposed to be the king. I'm up here with these stupid sheep. I don't know. That one there keeps rubbing his butt on his tree. I can't even get him to stop. What am I doing here? I'm supposed to be the king. My brothers are in battle. I'm not even in battle. I'm sitting here doing nothing. Not getting anywhere. I don't know if you've ever felt like that. I'm laboring in obscurity. Nobody sees me. Nobody knows me. King. King. What? When everybody else dies? I mean, I don't know how I'm supposed to get there. But he doesn't have to worry, right? Because God has a plan for all of this. And he's basically telling David, you're going to learn how to be my king. And when you're ready, I'll put you in battle. And not until. But what David doesn't know is this is the day. He didn't wake up today thinking, oh, you know what? Today I'm going to fight the most famous battle in history that ever was and ever will be. But he did. But it starts off with a bag. Hey, could you take this to your brothers? Can you take it off and go ahead and do that? That's how it starts out. And he's obedient, which is the amazing thing is God will do what he needs to do with you if you're just obedient. Just do whatever it is in front. So he reaches the camp as the army was going out to its battle positions. I love battle positions. They're going to go there and stand for the day. Shouting the war cry, Israel and the Philistines were drawing up their lines facing each other. David left his things with the keeper of supplies. He's like, oh, the battle. Oh, I want to see it. You know, he's excited. This is a kid. In those days, that was like, you know, watching a football game or something. This is a big deal. The army of Israel is going to be squaring off against those stinky Philistines. I want to see this. So he leaves him. He runs towards his brothers to ask how they're doing. Okay, which was part of his instruction, by the way, find out how they're doing. But, oh, this is exciting. You know, he's exciting. So he's going to go talk to them. Now, I want you to picture this for the soldiers who are standing around who have been doing nothing for 40 days. Now there's a kid with, like, stars in his eyes. Oh, you guys are the army. Wow, look at that. Look at that. Oh, that star looks sharp. Oh, this. You know, they're like, yeah, it's not easy being a soldier in Israel. You know, you can see them kind of getting all there. Oh, yeah, this is good. And so as he was talking with them, Goliath comes out. Man, can you imagine what that feels like? Oh, man, not in front of the kid. You know, why does he have to come today? Why now? They know he's coming out. Because he does every day. In fact, he comes out twice a day. Like clockwork, he comes out. Now, have you ever had a situation in your life where tomorrow morning something bad was going to happen to you and you knew it the night before? I don't know. You know, some kind of review at work that you knew wasn't going to go well. Some appointment in court. You're waiting for a diagnosis from a doctor. And you're like, man, tomorrow I do not want to wake up. Do you know how hard it is to sleep the night before? You know that pit of cold feeling you have in your stomach from that, like, and this is what they must have after 40 days, this dread. This guy's going to come and mock us and scare us all. And here in the middle of this, David's there. That's exciting. Here he comes, ruining the moment, because now they're going to look bad in front of the kid who was just talking about how great they were. And so the men of Israel, when they saw the man, were dreadfully afraid. But I want you to see this. It says Goliath, the champion of the Philistines, coming up from the armies, coming up. They even say, here comes this man coming up. Remember how it started? Meet me down there and I'll fight you. But now he's coming up. You know what that means? That means Goliath has gone down the hill, crossed the creek, and is halfway up their hill on the other side, challenging them. He's gotten closer. He's gotten bolder, because when left unopposed, a giant will always take more ground. If you have a giant in your life, you know this. Avoiding it doesn't help. It just keeps encroaching on more territory and keep making it worse and worse and worse. You want to know if you have a giant in your life? Here's how you do it. Tell yourself, because I don't know what it is, but there's something in your life, right? Everybody has something. And there's like, I don't know if. Here's what you do. Say out loud what that giant can't do. You know what? I've been sinning with this sin I can't seem to beat. But I'm not doing this, not today. And draw the line of sand and watch him cross it. Watch you do what you swore you wouldn't do. Say it out loud because Satan can't read your thoughts. Say it out loud. I'm not going to do this. I've sinned here, but at this time I'm stopping right here. I'm not going to let that happen. And watch it cross. Because a giant always takes more territory. And that's just waving a red flag in front of a bull is all that is. So David asked the man standing near him, well, what would be done for the man who actually kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? And then I love this. This is just so human. He says this, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Which means David made fun of his junk, because that's what guys do. I'm telling you, this is what guys do. Anybody's ever involved in kind of, you know, all kind of things we say about people, right? All kind of things. This is what he's doing. This is uncircumcised, because he goes there. He goes right there. This uncircumcised Philistine, who is he that he should defy the armies of the living God? I want you to see the difference between David's viewpoint and theirs. Because he said, are you not the soldiers of Saul? And David says, no, they're not. This is the army of the living God. And there's a huge difference there. Because when Saul stepped out, he was scared. And if I'm the army of the Saul who's afraid, guess what I am? But the living God's not afraid. And David just spent 3 years with the Holy Spirit learning what the living God does. He's not afraid either. He's saying, I'm wondering why nobody has taken care of this loudmouth yet. There must be a reward. What's the reward? Must not be high enough. The guys must be hanging around just waiting until the reward gets higher. And one of them says, well, the king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt his family from taxes in Israel. That's pretty good. My guess is the first 10 days, it was just great wealth. He adds a daughter to the mix the next 20 or so, and then finally adds up the exemption from taxes. Although we meet his daughter later, she's no prize. But hey, you know, marrying a princess, not all bad. And David must be looking around like, why is this guy still alive then? I mean, how is it this guy's still there? But Eliab still sees his little brother. Eliab, when he sees him speaking, is angry. He says, why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? Don't you have something, don't you have a couple sheep you're taking care of or something like that? You little petty shepherd. Go back to your sheep field. How arrogant you are. I know how arrogant you are and how wicked your heart is, which, by the way, can't be true because God literally picked him because of his heart, right? You just came down to see a fight. You just want to see a fight. You don't care how it happens. You're trying to get us provoked into a fight. You don't know what it takes to be a soldier. You know, can you imagine that? And David's probably, yeah, I don't think I can stay there for 4 days and listen to that. So if that's what it takes to be a soldier of the army of Saul, you're right. Don't think I can do that very well. So the interesting thing is that you have to understand when you go to step out on faith to do God's will, expect someone close to you to oppose you. Ask me how I know. Expect it. How do I know? Because I dealt with it. My own family. But you shouldn't be surprised by that. They did it to Jesus, right? Remember this? The multitudes are coming to see him. And they're coming so fast and furious, his disciples, and he couldn't even so much as eat. Now, here's Jesus, has got his disciples, the multitudes keep coming to hear him speak, and his family is embarrassed. They're embarrassed. His own family heard about this. They went out to lay hold of him, and they said, he's out of his mind. Shh, don't listen to him. I don't know what he's talking about, Messiah. Just get away. His own family said he's crazy. You should expect that when you step out to oppose the Satan's, I don't care what it is, somebody close to you can say, oh, you don't want to do that. That doesn't make any sense at all. What are you doing? But see, this is the whole point about David, though, is that he had a heart that was tuned to God. right? And I don't know if you ever, there's this really cool thing on guitars called a harmonic. And you have a string on a guitar and you pluck a string, it gives you a note, right? There are three places on a guitar. You can just barely touch a string and hit it, and it hits the note an octave above that. And you don't have to press it down. It sounds like a tuning fork. Boom, right? And if you play the guitar long enough, you'll start hearing harmonics. When you play a regular chord, you'll hear harmonics coming up out of it. This is called being tuned to the instrument. And the instrument that David was tuned to was the heart of God. So when the heart of God beat, he could feel the ping. And so when David saw that giant coming up and challenging and defying the army of the living God, God's heart beat, and so did David's, in a different way. And anger formed. And David responds, I love how he responds, now what have I done? He's like, I'm so tired of you, big brother. Again, I got two older ones. I know how he feels. Is there not cause to speak? You're okay with this? You want to talk about me? You're okay with that? And you want to talk about me? And then David does something really smart. He turns away from Eliab and goes back to talking to the guy he was talking to. Because there's no sense of talking to Eliab. Eliab still sees him as a 13-year-old kid. He doesn't see him as a future king of Israel. But I want to show you that Eliab reacted to the giant out of fear. He was deadly afraid that Goliath was going to hear him talking and going to use that as part of his smack. And he just wants him to shout when he's going to shout and walk away. It would be all right if the giant just goes back to where he was. We were fine before. Just shut up and let him go. But David reacted to the giant as he had been trained, because spiritual reflexes are different. And so the reaction is different. I want you to see that David didn't think about what he was saying. It was instinctive reflex. You know, like you hit the knee and boom, right? That's how David reacted. What? He said, what about my God? Oh, no. Oh, no. That can't be right. He just reacted that way. Everybody else was reacting completely in a human nature. Well, he could kick my butt. I'm staying here. Shh, quiet. He's big. See how big he is? You know? It's like, man, that guy stands 9 foot high. David says, my God stands higher. I don't care. His reactions are simply different. So he turns away to someone else and brought up the same matter as before, and the man replied the same thing. And when what David said was overheard and reported to Saul, Saul sent for him. Now he has no idea who he is yet. He has heard somebody said, I'm going to take down that Goliath. I'll take him. And Saul says, send me that man. Now, again, remember, Saul's not worried about losing the battle because of one fight. But he would love to shut up Goliath, or at least for a day, make him have to shut up. You know, maybe if the guy gets killed, he can hit Goliath in the mouth or something, make him not shout as much. So he goes, he sends for him, and so David shows up. Now, there's a part we kind of skipped over here in the scripture, but I'm going to hit you with it now. Saul knows who David is when he sees him. David has been playing musical instruments, the lyre, for Saul. Every time the wicked spirit, evil spirit came upon him, that brought him relief. Saul knows who David is when he sees him. And you have to remember that, because they're going to act like they don't know each other. And the reason why Saul acts like he doesn't know David is because he was going there in secret to play for him, because Saul's cracking up. And nobody wanted to know. Remember, one of the qualifications, he had to be well-spoken. They had to know that he could keep a secret. So we're all going to pretend like he doesn't know who Saul is. Saul's going to pretend like he doesn't know who David is. It's not so much this, but later on in the next sermon, you're going to see he completely pretends like he isn't there. But as soon as he sees him walking, he says, oh, David. But he likes David. He likes David a lot, in fact. Because they've gotten to know each other. He even let him be his armor bearer in some ceremonies and things. He likes David. And when he saw David, his heart probably leapt and then fell. Because he probably didn't care about sending somebody else to their death, but he doesn't want to send David to his. And you can kind of see his attitude changes. First, well, send that guy to me. And then David walks and says, oh, this guy. I'm the David, come on now. You're 16. And you play a liar. L-Y-E-R, not he's a liar. He plays an instrument, you know? You're a guitarist. Guitarists, you have rock cellos. They don't, you know, fight people. That's what drummers do. David says to Saul this, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Now, I want to show you that he's actually using words here that maybe he didn't know. We don't really know how much the little town of Bethlehem had of the scriptures. Everything had to be hand-copied and everything. So it's possible he's never heard what he's about to say before in his life, except what the Holy Spirit whispered in his ear. Or it's possible he was listening once when they read it and it stuck to him. But now he's going to quote something, a scripture. When he says this, he's saying, "Let no one else lose heart on account of this Philistine." He's referencing Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy. This is going all the way back to Moses' day when Moses told the Israelites this. "So it shall be when you're on the verge of battle," that's where they are, right? "The priest shall approach and speak to the people, and he shall say to them, 'Hear, O Israel, today you're on the verge of battle with your enemies. Do not let your heart faint.'" This is what David's doing. He's basically quoting Deuteronomy. "Don't let the heart of anyone here faint because of this jerk. Do not be afraid." And the reason is we don't tremble. We're not terrified. "For the Lord your God is he who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies." See, David wasn't standing there saying, "I can beat that giant." He was sitting there saying, "Don't let anybody's heart get faint. We're on the verge of battle. And that guy there is going to have to deal with my God. He is going to go before me and fight this battle." And that's why he's fearless, because God's undefeated. And this is something that no one else saw, because he is tuned to the heart of God. And he knows God wants that loudmouth shut up. And because of that, he knows for a fact God's going to fight that battle. No doubt in his mind. "Yeah, I'll do it. I'll do it." And Saul says, "You can't. You're not able to go out and fight against this Philistine. You are only a young man, and he has been a warrior since he's been a young man. He's been a warrior for as long as you've been alive. He knows things you don't know. He knows how to fight. He has a spear, he has a javelin, he has a sword, and he knows how to use them all. Not to mention the fact he's 9'9" and stronger than you, because you're a 16-year-old Jewish kid. You're not very big. Come on, have you ever seen a Jewish kid play basketball? I mean, have you ever seen, you know, 7-foot basketball? No, you don't see that, do you? I'm just saying what's there. Saul, you see, reacted to the giant out of fear for David's life, which is different. You would think his brother would have done that, but no, his brother's afraid of the giant himself. But Saul is not afraid of the giant because he knows he's going to stay on that side of the battle. But now he's afraid for David's life. But they both said things which are dumb to David, wrong for David, because they're motivated by fear. Eliab said, "Shh, shh, 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 this giant will hear you and he'll kill us. Shut up." Saul says, "Oh man, no, that giant will kill you." In both cases, one saying, "Be quiet," and the other one saying, don't fight. But they're both reacting from the same place, fear. And I'm just going to say, fear-based advice is always wrong. You know how I know it's wrong? Because God cannot give you fear-based advice. It is physically impossible for God to give you fear-based advice, because we know this: there is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. God couldn't give you fear-based advice if he wanted to, because as soon as God steps in, fear runs away. God's advice will never come to you from fear. It never comes to you from a place of fear. Be careful who you go to for advice. You want someone whose heart is tuned to God. You want advice from God, not fear. And David says this to Saul: "Look, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep, I went after it. I struck it and rescued the sheep from its mouth. And when it turned on me, I seized it by its hair and I struck it and I killed it. We went over this last week." Nobody does this. Nobody does this. Some 15-year-old kid surely doesn't do this. A bear is a little over 9 feet tall. David is not imagining his victory. He's remembering it. "Oh, I fought someone that tall before. He's quick. I fought a lion. I remember the battle with a lion. I remember the battle with the bear. And I remember God saved me from the paw. And this guy's strong, but he's not as strong as a bear. And he's fast, but he's not as fast as a lion. And my God is the same today as he was then. Nothing's changed. And therefore, Saul, I can do this. I killed both a lion and a bear. I've killed them both. And this, I love it again, uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them because he has defied the armies of the living God. They're not yours. They're Jehovah's. And Jehovah is not going to stand for this. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion, the paw of the bear, will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. I have fought worse than this. That's how I know. I'm not imagining it. I'm remembering it. I know what God's capable of. And I know God wants this guy to shut up. And then Saul basically says, it's your funeral. Okay. Go. May the Lord be with you. And the only reason he's sending him, he thinks he's sending him to his death. He's like, oh, I'm going to get myself a new lute player. But he's not worried about having to give up the army or anything stupid like that. But he's okay, yeah, well, at least it'll keep him quiet for one day. Go ahead. Go ahead, David. If you think you can do it, you go ahead and do it. So I'm just going to sum up some things here. Satan establishes strongholds in our lives if we let him. And there's a lot of ways we let the giants into our life. I'm going to give you just a couple. Unforgiveness is number one. Be angry and do not sin, Paul says. Do not give place to the devil. Unforgiveness will allow him in your life. He will set up a stronghold and he will win because you've allowed him. So bitterness, roots of bitterness in your life, unforgiveness is the number one way that Satan establishes strongholds in your life. It may come out in other areas. It may come out in an addiction. It may come out in family problems, or it may come out in all kinds of different things, but the root of it's bitterness, and the root of it is anger and unforgiveness. And that includes anger against God. We have given Satan liberty to be there. And if we've given him liberty to be there and we tell him to leave, he's just going to laugh. So here's the other thing. The giant will roar condemnation at you. The giant roars. I want you to see that. He was bellowing. He was roaring. It's almost unfair because the giant roars and God speaks in a still voice. It's almost unfair. That's why you need to spend time in training camp hearing that voice. If you get really good at hearing that voice, you can hear it even in the midst of the roar. He will mock you, he will condemn you, and he will tell you that you will always be his slave. See, the Holy Spirit convicts, Satan condemns. The Holy Spirit convicting sounds like this. Come on, man, you're better than this. Come on. You're better than this. You can be better than this. That's conviction. You did something wrong, okay, but you're better than this, and it's pulling you along. Condemnation sounds like this. See, you always do this. You've always been like this. You're a loser. You've always been a loser. You'll always be a loser. You're not going to beat this. You can't beat this. It's always going to be here all day long. See, that's the giant speaking. It'll condemn you. If you react in fear, he'll just keep taking more territory from you. It's amazing how many Christians have given Satan place in their lives and wondering whether spiritual life is failing. I've heard, I can't tell you how many times, this. I try to read the Bible at night, and it puts me to sleep. My advice, by the way, well, then go to bed early, read the Bible, go to sleep, wake up early, and read the Bible in the morning. Why is that? Why does read nothing else put you to sleep? Just the Bible. You don't think that's a spiritual attack? You don't think the devil has a place right now in your life and he's using that place to keep you from reading the Bible? Because he does not want you to read the Bible. Same thing with prayer. You try to pray, I can't do corporate prayer, I get intimidated. Oh, I can't pray like those people. You need to come to prayer meeting sometime. Everybody prays differently. Some of the best prayers are those that are just direct, to the point. No one's judging anybody. But the devil will get in your head and tell you they are. Oh, you pray like that. They're going to know you're not a real Christian. You don't know how to use all the words. The devil will get in your head because you've given him place. We need to get him out of our life. In Ephesians, Paul says, you're given weapons for this. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. David is the only one who saw that. Everybody else saw the giant. See, the thing is, what David saw is scarier. Well, I don't see a giant. I see a stronghold of the enemy. Lucky for me, I believe in a God who tears down strongholds of the enemy. He's the only one who saw the spiritual aspect of all this. We're on the verge of a battle. God told us what to do here. He told us what to expect here. We're going to do what God said. We're going to fight against the spiritual principalities, and the giant will fall. That's not a problem. Spiritual warfare, though, requires spiritual weapons. And we'll talk about this next week, but when David goes forth to fight the battle, he does not do it conventionally. He does not take a sword or javelin or a spear. None of the weapons that are being used by the giant will he use until he picks up the giant's own sword and cuts off his head. But up until then, he fights with weapons the giant has never seen before. And that's what we do. We're given those weapons. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not physical, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That's what our weapons do. Our weapons are given to us for that purpose, not fighting these little tiny wars on Facebook. Facebook may be evil, but it's not a stronghold. Okay, so I'm going to actually break this sermon right here because we're going to get into the details of it next week, which is really, really great. But I just want to say, if you are fighting a giant in your life, are you ready? Do you know how to use these weapons? Do you practice with these weapons? Or do you just suddenly realize, oops, I needed that and I don't have it? Today, Stas came over to help us work. We have this projects that keep falling behind. So he came over to help. And one of the things I have is I have this pile of dirt in my front yard that I need to move to where the septic tank was dug up to smooth it out. And so before he left, he said, let me see how many of those wheelbarrow fulls of that I can get. It was like half a truck dumped. So I'm out there watching him. Because I can't, I'm tired. So I'm watching him fill up this wheelbarrow and literally run up the hill with it, like dump it, go back. He's trying to get as many as he can. I'm like, whoa, okay. I could do it, but I couldn't do it like that. And maybe when I was 20, I could have, but I can't do it today, you know. And I'm watching him do this, and I'm realizing, boy, it must be great to be 30 again. That would be awesome if I were 30 again. But it also occurred to me that when I was 30, I didn't have Stas' strength because it never worked out like Stas works out, right? And this is the thing that's interesting to me is that we don't, and then we wonder why we don't have it when we need it. I can't do that. Well, maybe one of the reasons I can't do that is I didn't spend my whole life working out. So we face spiritual battles, you see, without ever done the spiritual workout. We don't know how to use the Bible. We don't even know what's in there. Well, we don't know how to use prayer. We only know what other people have done. I can't use other people's prayer methodology for me. It won't work. I don't know how to use these weapons. And then the giant comes, and it's too late to learn. So I go, and I get my butt kicked by the giant, and I complain to God. Why is this giant beating me up all the time? So why don't you learn how to use the weapons I gave you? Right? The giant's coming. If he's not already in your life, he's coming, because he always does. Everybody has it. The question is, are you going to be ready for him when he gets there or not? Would you all please pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you that you give us people like David to look up to and admire, but I thank you more that you give us weapons that David used to use. Not slingshots and swords. You gave us more powerful weapons than that. Forgive us, Lord, for not getting them out of the scabbard and using them. Forgive us for making excuses for why we haven't spent the time learning how to use the weapons of warfare that you have given us. Lord, we desperately need more Bible in our lives. We need to be able to quote scripture rather than song lyrics. We need prayer in our life. We know how to lift up our voice in prayer. For this is how strongholds are brought down. Help us be giant killers.